Hello friends, as part of Civil Speed, a current affairs today's discussion, so we'll be looking at Bandipur National Park, constitutional status for OBC Commission, and the doll lock would be discussed on prelims perspective, whereas in case of e-commerce policy, so that was published recently, so would be discussed in terms of the mains perspective. When it comes to the first topic for today, so here the news is that the Ministry of Road Transport and Highways so has asked the Karnataka government to lift the ban through the Bandipur National Park. As you know that since 2009, the Karnataka government has imposed night ban on the National Highway 766 through this Bandipur National Park on the grounds of disturbance to the wildlife as well as the in order to avoid the accidents leading to the death of these wild animals. So here, what you have to focus in Plin's point of view? The keywords that were mentioned in this article is that so the Bandipur National Park and Nilgiri Biosphere Reserve, National Tiger Conservation Authority, Ministry of Environment, Forests and Climate Change, and the Wildlife Protection Act 1972, as well as Project Tiger. So these are the keywords that were mentioned in these articles. So when it comes to the discussion of the keywords in Prelims point of view, so consider the first topic, that is the Bandipur National Park that was in the news. So here you can expect the questions like that. So whether this Bandipur National Park is located in the state of the Karnataka or its extension is also there in the state of the Tamil Nadu. So that kind of clear factual data is essential. So here the National Highway 766 is passing through this Bandipur National Park. So this Bandipur National Park is also the part of Nilgiri Biosphere Reserves. Apart from this Bandipur National Park, there is another three more important wildlife sanctuaries and national park. So that is the Nagarhole, the national park, the Wayanad Wildlife Sanctuary, Mudumalai Wildlife Sanctuary. These four wildlife sanctuaries and national park constitutes the Nilgiri Biosphere Reserves. As you know that this Nilgiri Hills is a tri-junction point of the state of the Kerala, state of the Karnataka and the state of Tamil Nadu. It is a tri-junction and it is one of the biggest tiger, biggest biosphere reserves in the country. So I repeat that this Nilgiri Biosphere Reserves so consists of the Bandipur National Park, the Nagarhole National Park, the Wayanad, which is located in Kerala state, wildlife sanctuary and the Mudumalai Wildlife Sanctuary that is located in Tamil Nadu are part of this Nilgiri Biosphere Reserves. Another keyword that is mentioned in this article is that so National Tiger Conservation Authority, so which was established under the provisions of this Wildlife Protection Act of 1972 under the Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change. This NTCA was headed by the Union Ministry of Environment. And the major function of this NTCA is the implementation of this Project Tiger, which was formulated in 1973. The aim of this Project Tiger is conservation of the endangered species of tiger in the country. As you know that India is home to the largest population of tigers in the country, and this Project Tiger is 100% centrally funded scheme and it is implemented by National Tiger Conservation Authority, which was headed by the Union Minister of Environment. Coming to the next topic, so here the news is that the Lok Sabha unanimously passed the 123rd constitutional amendment giving the constitutional status to the OBC panel. So that is the news article. So in this article, what has to be focused in prelims point of view? So here the keywords that are mentioned is that so 123rd constitutional amendment act giving the constitutional status to the BC panel. So that is the National Commission for Backward Classes. The articles that are mentioned is Article 338B and Article 342A, and the what is the composition of this National Commission and the members, how these members were appointed, so what is the duration of their tenure and major functions of this National Commission for Backward Classes, so would be given priority in prelims point of view. So when it comes to the 123rd constitutional amendment, so this constitutional amendment so aims at giving the constitutional status to the present statutory commission of National Commission for Backward Classes. As you know that there is a National Commission for Backward Classes Act 1993. So by giving the statutory status so of the National Commission for Backward Classes, it means that the existing statutory commission of National Commission for Backward Classes, so the major function of the statutory commission of this NCBC is that, so giving the advisory recommendation to the Government of India for inclusion or exclusion of any backward community that is enlisted in the central list of the backward classes, and also taking care of the welfare measures and protecting the rights, and also the examination of the complaints that are received for the backward classes. That is the existing function of this statutory National Commission for Backward Classes. But by having the constitutional status for the existing statutory body, so would be having the much more authority. It means that we are elevating the authority of the existing statutory commission. So by having the constitutional authority, having the welfare measures consideration and the consideration of the welfare measures, and also the protecting the rights in terms of the constitutional provisions, the statutory provisions, or any policy issues that would impact the socially, educationally backward classes in the country. So by having the constitutional status to the proposed National Commission for Backward Classes. As I mentioned that here only the socially, educationally backward classes, but not the economical backward classes. So you have to keep it in mind that, so it's a socially, educationally backward classes, but not the socially, economically backward classes. So by having this 123rd Constitutional Amendment Act, we are going to include two more articles. The first article is that Article 338B. On the lines of Article 338 and Article 338A. As you know that these two articles gives the constitutional status to the National Commission for Scheduled Castes. So that is dealt by Article 338. And the National Commission for Scheduled Tribes is dealt by the Article 338A. So similarly, we'll be having one more additional article, that is the Article 338B. So which deals exclusively the National Commission for Backward Classes. So which is meant for protecting the welfare and the rights and receiving the and examination of the complaints that you receive in case of socially, educationally backward sections in the country. So this Article 338B would consist of all the necessary provisions right from its title, composition and the functions. So these are the provisions that were there in the Article 338B. But when it comes to the Article 342A, it consists of the definition of the socially, educationally backward classes. So how these socially, educationally backward classes would be defined, and on what basis this list of the central list consisting of socially, educational backward classes in the country, so would be enlisted. So that is the provision under Article 342A. The president, in consultation with the governor of the respective states, would promulgate the central list of the socially, educationally backward classes for the purpose of Article 338B. So that is the actual provision that is there in Article 342A. So clearly know the difference between Article 338B and Article 342A. So if the first list of the socially, educational backward classes is released, suppose in the future, if any inclusion or exclusion of this list is to be modified, the approval of the parliament is necessary. So in that case, the president, so they preliminarily may seek the advice of this National Commission for Backward Classes based on the report. So the president can seek the authorization of the parliament. When it comes to the composition of this National Commission for Backward Classes, it is a 5-member committee. So mainly consists of the chairman, vice chairman, and 3 more members of this NCBC. So appointed by the president. So right now this amendment bill, so is not having the exclusive details with respect to the qualifications of these members and the chairmen of this commission. Maybe these rules that are necessary, having the qualification in order to appoint this to the constitutional body of NCBC, so would be authorized in the future. So when it comes to the functions of this NCBC, so by having the constitutional status, so it would be having the constitutional authority with respect to the welfare and the rights protection with respect to the socially educational backward classes, and also So examination of the complaints that are received with respect to the socially educational backward classes. So remaining the functions of the existing statutory NCBC, so more or less similar to the proposed constitutional NCBC. So I could say that it's a mere changing moving from the statutory status to the constitutional status. So almost the remaining provisions and the functions of this NCBC are more or less similar. But having the constitutional status, so it would be on par with the National Commission for Scheduled Castes, National Commission for the Scheduled Tribes. So it would give an edge over, so examination of the complaints that are received with respect to the complaints involving the violation of the rights with respect to the socially educationally backward classes. So it would be having the status of the civil court. But one point you have to note it down is that, so the recommendations of this constitutional body is advisory in nature. So whatever the recommendations that is given by this NCBC is not binding on the government. When it comes to the next topic, so assessment shows that the size of the water body has come down by half. So this article is with respect to Dal Lake, which was there in the state of the Jammu and Kashmir. So the background for this article is that, so in 2018 prelims question paper, so there was one question. So that is, the question is that they have given three lakes. So that is a Black Sea and the Baikal Lake and Aral Sea. So of the given lakes, the question is framed. So which of the given lakes have been shrunk? So so because of the human activities. So that is the question that was there in the 2018 question paper. On the similar lines, so in India also, so Dal Lake is facing the encroachment. That means the storage capacity of this Dal Lake has been reduced to the half because of the human activities. So there is another lake that was recently in the news again and again, is Bellandoru Lake of Bangalore. So this Dal Lake is known as the jewel in the crown of the Srinagar city. So here the issue is that the Jammu and Kashmir governor has requested the Navy chief, that is Sunil Lamba, to assist the dredging operation in order to restore the capacity of this Dal Lake. Here the reasons, here the key points that has to be noted is that, so the Dal Lake facts, so whether it is a fresh water body or saline, it is a fresh water body, but because of the pollution, that is because of the dumping of this untreated sewage into this lake, so now the present pollution level is makes that the water of this Dal Lake is not potable. So reasons for the pollution and what kind of solution one can make in order to restore this Dal Lake storage capacity, and what kind of benefits after having restoring this Dal Lake would be given priority. So these are the keywords that we are going to discuss. When it comes to the present status is that, so almost the half of the area of this Dal Lake has been shrunk because of the discharging of this untreated sewage into this lake, and also dumping of the night soil. So there is a mentioning of the keyword, that is night soil, in the article. So what is meant by night soil? It's simply just like a human excrement, so without any water. I could say that it is a human excreta without water. So mainly in the medieval time, this night soil is dumped nearby the water lakes or nearby the fields. So on this night soil, after some time, would be used as a fertilizer for the agriculture. So when it comes to the reasons for this present shrinkage is that, so discharging of untreated sewage into this lake and dumping of this night soil into this Dal Lake, so has led to the shrinking of this area by half. So when it comes to the solutions of this restoration of the Dal Lake is that, so there are two solutions one can advise for restoring of this Dal Lake capacity is that, first and foremost is that we should be having the adequate number of sewage treating plants in and around of this Dal Lake, so that furthermore we can stop the discharging of untreated sewage into this Dal Lake. And the second solution is that, so we should be having the dredging operation, so that whatever the pollution, whatever the unwanted soil or waste that is there in the Dal Lake can be taken it away. By having this comprehensive solution, we can restore the full capacity of this Dal Lake. So what is the benefits of having this restoration of this Dalek is that, so the mitigation of the floods would be very easy, and the Don Lake is a economic, I mean this Don Lake is providing the economic activity to the people who are residing in and around of this Don Lake. So it means that we can promote the commercial fishing, so we can promote the commercial horticultural. So, and this Don Lake is also one of the important tourist spot in the state of Jammu and Kashmir. So other, when it comes to the other interesting facts of this Don Lake is that, so it is known as jewel in the crown of Srinagar city. There are another three more lakes very near this Dal Lake is that, so Wolar Lake and Anchar Lake. There is a Wolar Lake, Anchar Lake. So this Wolar Lake, Anchar Lake and Dal Lake are the freshwater bodies in the state of Jammu and Kashmir. And this Jhelum River is not passing through the Dal Lake. It is passing through the Wolar Lake, but it is not passing through the Lake of Dal. Now, we are going to discuss the proposed e-commerce policy. Here, the article says that the draft e-commerce policy has too many echoes from the license permit quota, a system that was existing prior to 1991. So here, this policy would be discussed in comprehensive manner, particularly in Maine's perspective. So before going to discuss actual key provisions of this policy, so we'd be starting with the background for this policy and the objectives and key provisions and what are the criticism against this and way forward. So these are the key dimensions we are going to looking at, so under this proposed e-commerce policy. So when it comes to the background for this proposed e-commerce policy, so as you know that because of the day by day increasing the usage of the smartphones and the level of the penetration of the internet, the e-commerce platform has emerged as a one of the best performing sector in the entire economy of Indian sector. So here right now it was estimated that so this the size of the e-commerce is about $20 billion. So right now the size of the e-commerce is about $25 billion. So it was proposed that so maybe with the present rate of the growth it could reach $1 trillion size of the economy by 2022. Again, the research report says that by 2030 almost 50% of the entire economy would be on the electronic platform. So that is the importance of the e-commerce component in the Indian economy. So, but we have a very importance to the e-commerce, but right now we don't have any exclusive policy in order to deal with this e-commerce. And also at the same time, we don't have any single regulator in order to regulate all the components with respect to the e-commerce. So with this background, the present government has come up with the draft e-commerce policy aiming that, so the policy aims at promoting the e-commerce in the country without compromising the data privacy and national security. So this is the major objective of this policy. When it comes to the key provisions that were there in the e-commerce policy is that, so the policy aims at there shall be a single national e-commerce regulator, so regulating the all the components of this e-commerce sector. Also the policy aims at, so there shall be a specialized course in order to deal with the consumer complaints, so in a timely manner. So as you know that in the e-commerce business, the financial frauds are implicit. So in order to deal with these financial frauds, so there shall be a specialized course and there shall be a single regulator. So that is a very welcome initiative in the policy itself. And also the policy aims at, so there shall be a level playing field between offline. It means that offline trade and also online trade. So how this level playing field would be achieved? So as you know that there are certain distorting trade practices, particularly on the electronic platform, in terms of offering the flash sales, having the deep discounts. So you might be knowing that the Amazon, Flipkart, they're offering 30%, 50% discount. So for a shorter period of the three days or 4 days. So that means the duration of the sale is very limited and the discount is very, 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 very high. So this trade practices in terms of allowing the deep discounts only for particular period of time is distorting the trade competitive policies, the competitiveness between the offline trade and online trade. So that's why the policy has come up with the sunset clause. So what is the meaning of the sunset clause? So by adopting this policy, within 2 years after adopting this policy, the whatever the e-trade commerce platforms offering the deep discounts has to be ended. Otherwise, the duration of this discount to sale has to be increased at least for 2 weeks. So that means that there is a sunset clause in order to avoid the distorting trade practices between the offline trade and online trade. Otherwise, if the e-commerce platforms wants to allow the deep discounts, the discount to sale has to be at least 2 or more than 3 weeks. So that is the one major component. And the policy aims at the 49% FDA in inventory models. So in order to discuss this, what is the meaning of inventory model? We have two models. One is that marketplace model. Another one is inventory model. The fundamental difference between the marketplace e-commerce and the inventory model of e-business is that in case of marketplace e-commerce business, so the electronic platform, that is the e-commerce firm, so mainly provides a facilitation link between the buyers and sellers. So in this case, like the Amazon, Flipkart and Snapdeal, so these are the examples for the marketplace e-commerce platforms. So these platforms like Amazon, Snapdeal, Flipkart, so they're not maintaining the inventory. It means that they're not maintaining the stocks. So even they don't have any effective logistical infrastructure in order to complete this e-commerce business. So they're just providing the link between the sellers and buyers. So that is the meaning of marketplace e-commerce business. But when it comes to the inventory model of e-commerce, the example for this inventory model for e-commerce business is that Alibaba. In case of Alibaba, is also maintaining inventory. That means it maintains the stocks and also it is having the necessary infrastructure, that is the logistics that is required for completing this e-commerce. So that is the fundamental difference. So right now, at present, 100% FDA is involved. I mean that right now, 100% FDA is allowed in case of marketplace e-commerce business, but there is no allowing of FDA in case of inventory model. But this policy aims at allowing the 49% of FDI through automatic route in case of inventory model of e-commerce business. But again, there is a one cautious clause in this model. It means that the companies partnering with the FDI, so the management shall be with the Indians only. So that is the component of Make in India. So the inventory model is for the goods which are produced locally has to be maintained by the Indians only. But in case of such models, the FDI allowing is 49%. So that means this policy promotes Make in India component. When it comes to the data localization, so what is meant by data localization? So as you know that whatever the data that is generated within the boundaries of the company has to be stored within the boundaries of the company, that is the meaning, within the boundaries of the country. So that is the meaning of data localization. So it means that whatever the generation of the data that is there in the within the boundaries of the country has to be stored within the boundaries of the country. So that is the one more requirement. So by having this data localization, this policy is in compliance of the proposed data protection law that is recommended by Justice B.N. Sri Krishna Committee report. Next one is that the policy enables India's 10 at the deliberations of WTO. As you know that there is a deliberations that is going on the WTO table with respect to the e-commerce. So almost all global tech giants, they're demanding for, so there shall be no difference between the global tech giants and the homegrown tech giants. But this policy enables India should be having very strong stand by protecting the homegrown e-commerce platform without minimizing so the Indians' interest. So that is the policy crux of this proposed policy. So now when it comes to the criticism, So there are three fundamental criticisms against this policy is there. So one is with respect to the protecting the consumer's interest. So there is a sunset clause within the policy. So the sunset clause is that, so whatever the existing deep discounts that are practiced by these e-commerce firms has to be end within the 2 years of adopting this policy. So it is against the protecting the consumer's interest. That means the consumers would be losing buying these goods at the discounted price. So that is with respect to the consumer's point of view. When it comes to the business community perspective, so requirement of this data localization, and also, so there is another component with respect to the FDA. So that 49% FDA is allowed in the inventory model of e-commerce, but at the same time, the management is given with respect to the Indians. So these are the two important hitching points with respect to the business community. The way forward is that, so right now the policy is the active consideration by the think tank that is constituted by the Ministry of Commerce and Industry. And we have to wait for the think tank observation of the proposed draft e-commerce policy. So I could say that the proposed e-commerce policy is very welcome, though it is a very late. So by protecting, by having the national regulator, by having the component of data protection, data localization, data privacy, and also the government can access the data, so on the grounds of national security, and also in case of the policy requirement, so within the framework of the consent clauses. So with this, we are closing the session. Thank you.